to celebrate the life work of Paul Fernhoff, who was our good friend and with whom we worked for many years, and his work here in Atlanta and throughout the world is still highly remembered. This is the fourth annual Paul Fernhoff Memorial Lecture. It's historical, I believe, the fact that it was the first event held in this auditorium when this building first opened. So that's of historic interest and so forth. It's always intriguing to me to be in Atlanta and in this building because the bridge that goes over to the medical school is named after one of my house officers, one of my house officer mates at Duke, George Brumley, whose family was very visible here, and George and his family were very close friends of mine. One of the great advantages to me of enjoying a very long life and good health has been the fact that I've had an opportunity to be around since newborn screening began. And I was talking this morning with Patricia Guthrie about the fact that when I ran the program at Hopkins and we were starting newborn screening for the very first time in the state of Maryland, of course, her father was well known and used to come down to Baltimore to visit, as he went everywhere, etc. However, the other thing that is interesting today is this is a very special week for newborn screening and for rare diseases. And there's a couple events that have happened in the past week and earlier this week that bear special attention, I think, and that is. First was the announcement a little while back that nusinersen trials had been discontinued because they had been shown to be so effective in spinal muscular atrophy. Again, the most common genetic fatal disease of childhood. And so needless to say, that observation is extraordinary. And of course, following on the heels of that, Biogen has taken an option to commercialize and produce this compound. So again, exciting news on the front of spinal muscular atrophy has been around a long time and for which we have so urgently needed treating for so long. Monday of this week, there were groundbreaking news from the FDA that they had approved the very first specific drug for the treatment of Duchenne muscular dystrophy. That was a controversial decision because there was a lot of conflict within the FDA about that decision. But if you read the fine print, it's hard for me to see why in the world or how in the world the FDA did not approve that. And fortunately, Commissioner Califf agreed with that decision. Let me just bring up one thing, but many of you in the room are very familiar with Duchenne muscular dystrophy. But tucked in the report that Sarepta filed with the FDA was the fact that 10 of the 12 boys who were treated with this drug were still walking after 4 years of the drug. That just doesn't happen, and so that's very exciting. Now, the reason that there are a variety of reasons this is very important for this particular group is that neither of these drugs produce new neurons or new muscle. So that means that there's an immediate, urgent requirement that we get newborn screening in place for spinal muscular atrophy and Duchenne muscular dystrophy in order to take maximum benefit of these drugs and so forth. It's traditional at these meetings, and the meetings have been going on long enough, I think, that we can talk indeed about traditional, that we have some word from the family of Paul in a welcome and remembrance, and that honor is passed around among the family. And this year, we're going to hear from Dr. Shana Fernhoff Cohen, who's going to provide welcoming and remembrance. Shana.
Good morning. On behalf of the Fernhoff family, I'd like to welcome all of you to the fourth Paul M. Fernhoff Memorial Lecture. We hope that you will find this lecture series as informative and inspiring as we do every year. My mother, my brother, and I are so proud to be part of this annual program, and we're very grateful to the many people who have nurtured it into being over the years here at Emory. Dr. Vogt, Dr. Hannon, Dr. Howell, Dr. Asmussen, Don Laney, and many others, thank you so much. By bringing in speakers such as Dr. Wenger to talk about groundbreaking work on rare disorders, you are helping to keep my father's memory alive in a very powerful way. This lecture series really furthers the impact of his contribution to medical genetics and ultimately to the lives of patients and their families. This is, of course, exactly the purpose that my dad would have wanted his name and his legacy to serve. Just a real quick story. A few weeks ago, my 8-year-old daughter, Paul's granddaughter, had a friend over from school, and I overheard her talking to this friend and taking her around the house to look at every photo that we have up on the walls. She would stop in front of each one and point out herself as a baby, point out other members of the family, who knew she was such an archivist. As she pointed to a picture of my dad, I heard her ask her friend in a very hushed and dramatic tone of voice, "You know the famous genetic doctor, Paul Fernhoff, right?" Well, he was my papa. Now, shockingly, this didn't prompt the reaction that she was hoping for. So she clearly needed to up the ante. Then creatively reinterpreting the results of a 23andMe test that my brother took a while back, she casually threw in, "Oh, and we might be related to Napoleon." I think that her papa would have appreciated getting the slightly higher billing. Thank you once again and welcome.
In 2008, 5 years after the death of their granddaughter, Michaela, with Krabbe disease, Paul and Sue Rosenau had the remarkable good fortune of winning a very large lottery. Unlike many lottery winners about whom we read in the newspaper, unfortunately some of us are not winners, the Rosenau's took a very different tack to make good use of their remarkable good fortune. They decided that they would put substantial funding into establishing a new foundation, which they named the Legacy of Angels. This particular foundation was dedicated to supporting research in Krabbe disease, cystic fibrosis, and other diseases, as well as supporting the importance of newborn screening. Paul and Sue, his wife, continued to work in their own jobs for a considerable period of time, but increasingly have devoted their principal attention to this important foundation and its work. I would like to introduce at this time Paul Rosenau, who's the co-founder of this foundation, who will introduce our keynote speaker today. Paul?
I've got a confession to make. And Dr. Wenger is sitting down there, I see a distressed look on his face. And the reason for that look is for the last 2 months, we knew that David was talking here at this event. And I've been raising the anticipation level for him. Because what I've been doing is, even inside of research, we are personal friends now. And I know some things about David and his wife, Joan. And I've been threatening to expose them at this meeting. And I'm going to surprise David right now, because what I have to say about him has nothing to do with his faults. We all have them. We all have faults. But here's my surprise. It is with great pleasure and honor for me to introduce our keynote speaker, Dr. David Wenger. David is a professor of neurology in the Sydney Kilme Medical College at Thomas Jefferson University. He received both his Bachelor of Science degree in pharmacy and his PhD in biochemistry from Temple University. David is certified in clinical biochemical genetics by the American Board of Medical Genetics. In 1973, David started a diagnostic laboratory for the diagnosis of certain lysosomal disorders, including Krabbe's disease. David performed the diagnosis of Krabbe's disease on our granddaughter, Michaela. And at that time, the research had not moved forward enough to be able to do anything for our granddaughter. Excuse me. After my wife and I started the Legacy of Angels Foundation, our relationship with David grew. David has devoted his career to Krabbe's research. We recognize David's passion to find a better treatment for the diagnosis with Krabbe's and have funded some of his research. We not only recognize and have high regard for David's research in Krabbe's, in the Krabbe's field, but also consider David and his wife Joan dear friends. Please join me in welcoming Dr. David Wenger.
At the University of Georgia and the samples that came to me for diagnostic work. And it's been about 33 years that I received samples from Paul asking for our help in diagnosing a child with one of our disorders that we could diagnose. At those days, probably those of you who have been here a while, Skip Elsis was sending samples, Dwayne Blackston was, and Paul. And we were happy to help him. And as you know, some of these disorders have gone on to treatable diseases, let me just go on to the just to give you an idea of what we do in the lab and how many we've diagnosed. Many of these disorders are leading the way in terms of enzyme replacement therapy. When I was a postdoc in John O'Brien's lab, the common cause of Tay-Sachs disease, we used to joke that more people were working on these diseases than had them, and I think we were off by a little bit. But don't forget the Tay-Sachs carrier testing program was the first genetic disease in which carriers were identified before the birth of a first child. And then it's been expanded to other panels for that community. But so with Paul's interest in this, the other thing I have to say is that I remember a smile, because we would sit in the New York State newborn screening meetings trying to get that working better, and sometimes I'd look across to Paul and he looked at me, and there's always was a smile on his face, and I liked to kid around, and I know he did too. So we always had a fun relationship, and I found out later that he went to Jefferson, where I am now, in Philadelphia. So just to give you an idea of what I've diagnosed, since 1993, I think I diagnosed the case of Niemann-Pick type A and a Krabbe disease. I think we had 3 sample requests that year. And it's gone up. And, you know, for my lab, these are not rare diseases. We've diagnosed now, we tally up at the end of the year, we've diagnosed about 4,500 patients with what people consider to be rare genetic diseases. I've highlighted Krabbe disease, where I think we have 12, 13 already this year. MLD, we have more, but not that many. Not every lab can diagnose Krabbe disease. Now, just so we understand what I'm working on, we are not talking about credit. Now, people who know me and know when I read lousy papers, I do get real crabby. I hate to see money wasted. I hate to see papers that are incorrect or don't move the field forward. But we are not talking about crabby genes today. We're talking about a disease that was well described by Nude Krabbe. Now, I should say that I should try to pronounce his name properly. It's not Krabbe. It's really crab with a little at the end of the crab. And that, when I've given a talk in Scandinavia, they laugh at me when I say crabbe. But I will digress, because I always forget to call it crabbe. but I'll try to remember. What is interesting about Dr. Krabbe, he wrote the definitive paper, which I'll show you in a second, in 1916. And when I tried to guess how long he had lived, you would think you write the seminal paper, how long he lived into the 30s, 40s. He lived to 1961, only 9 years before we knew the cause of Tay-Sachs disease. And I found that to be amazing that he lived that long to almost see the cause of this disease that he described so well. The other sad part about this, the last 10 years of his life, he had a terrible neurodegenerative disease. He was bedridden, he had weakness, and he had tremor. It was called paralysis agitans, and I'm sure it was Parkinson's disease. So here's a man who dedicated his life to pediatric neurology disorders, and he ends up having a neurodegenerative disease himself. Now, one thing is interesting here. This was his paper in 1916. This use of the diffuse brain sclerosis was used probably through the 40s, almost to 50, for many, Tay-Sachs disease, Canavan disease. It was a common term for nonspecific brain diseases where you didn't have a definitive cause. The other thing that I found interesting, if you want to be the editor of the journal Brain, you have to have the correct name. Henry Head was the editor of the journal. So he described five patients with diffuse brain sclerosis, and this gives you what we know today. They all presented usually from 4 to 6 months. They had crying, screaming, this irritability we hear about, and they had muscular problems, spasms, the head arched backwards, optic atrophy, and change in elevations and temperature, and many of them died between 1.5 and 18 months. This is a picture of a patient from Krabbe's paper. I said his name wrong, but Krabbe's paper. This is a picture I took maybe 15, 20 years ago of a patient in my laboratory. Now the talk goes from the bed to the bedside, the bedside to the bench, back to the bedside, but not every patient is in bed. Lorelei is a good friend of mine. I diagnosed her at age 26 when she had some spastic paresis. She had her first baby, her only baby, I'm sorry, when she was 40, and this is her she sent 2 weeks ago. So they're not all in bed. She had a sister who at age 4 became bedridden, wheelchair bound, and lived to 47, severely debilitated. And this brings up a point, and when it will come to treatment, is when you get this variability in late onset patients, how do you really confirm that it had a diagnostic, a treatment potential? Because if you would have treated her, we would be patting ourselves on the back and saying how wonderful it is. But it's not always that way. I have to point out some people that made a very big impact on our study. Dr. Chen came to me from China in 1989. He and I worked together, and he was amazing. I think he's the smartest person I've ever met. Whenever I would make a suggestion, he would say, I have a better one. Whenever I would say, why don't we try this, by the next day it was done. And we worked together so hard to try to purify this protein, which I had started in the early 70s. And in 1993, we purified the protein and cloned the cDNA. He died that year of cancer. And it brings tears in my eyes to think about what he could have been, who he could have been in either America or Chinese research. The other person, obviously, is Kuni Suzuki. And Kuni Suzuki was the one who, among someone else, who found the defect in 1970 that caused Krabbe disease. We competed head-on to try to purify this damn protein for all those years and years and years. And as he joked at the end, he says, your Chinese postdoc was better than my Japanese postdoc. And he's probably right. This is me. He lived in Chapel Hill at that time. He was at the University of North Carolina. And this is me at his house. I spent a couple of days down there in 1998 discussing where the research on this disease was going to go. And we remained good friends. He's retired, but I still keep in touch with him. And it was a great relationship to compete with someone, but remain friends. Now, we tried in brain, liver, placenta to purify this protein, and since 1973. And finally, you can see that one day I said, I'm going to see whether there's any activity in urine. So So you can see that Chen and I put this in 1991 in the men's room. Now, it says that we have a meager urinary output. We were trying to collect 120 gallons of urine. It was only in the men's room. I have nothing against Donald Trump. But, you know, we thought that would be easier to hit the container in the men's room. So we said here that if we collected all of it, each day we dumped it. Big 33-gallon trash cans all over the cold. I was not a popular guy. And I said you will all be acknowledged in our publication. Well, there were notes put on, the notes saying they contributed so much they wanted to be co-authors. So anyway, we eventually did purify this protein from human urine. Now, there was a lot of trouble. And one day, Chen and I were working till late at night. I came in the next morning and on his desk was this cartoon that he made. And we did have our ups and downs, purified the wrong protein once, made antibodies against the wrong protein. Anyway, I saw this on his desk and I snitched it. And it's Chen and I, he said, "Where are you, Gelsey? I'm here." And I kept it because he was a great guy and that's the way we worked together so much. Now, when we looked in urine, we saw bands that are about 50, this is a gel of protein, about 50,000 kilodalton and 30. And when we then went and used the techniques that we learned from urine and brain, we ended up getting a band that runs about 80. And then we realized, which I'll show you, is that this gets cut into these bands and this band. Now, in 1993, this is an old slide, I had some of my slides made into PowerPoint. I said, why should we clone that gene that causes Krabbe disease? And obviously it's like a mountain and it's a challenge, it's there. We wanted to understand the structure and the function of this enzyme. It would allow us to find mutations that cause all types. It would enable us to develop better diagnostic tests, better tests for prognosis. If it's a mild mutation, we may not have onset until later. It'll permit pre-implantation genetic diagnosis. We could use maybe potentially do enzyme replacement by making larger quantities and would open the way to gene therapy. So this was my thinking back around 1993. Now, right about 1997, we published the first paper showing where the 17 exons, the coding regions, this is where the 30 kilodalton coding region is, this is the 50, and these are mutations that are, missense mutations, these are more deletions. Now, just so you know, there'll be a test at the end of my talk. These are included, okay, so you better learn fast. Anyway, this is about 50 or 60. Now, in the latest edition that I put together, we're at 150 mutations that cause this disease. So, where are we going to go with treatment, and what's the problem with this disease? Well, we know it's caused by a mutation in the Gelsey gene. We know that causes an enzyme deficiency. You get a buildup of two of the substrates. There's actually a few more, but two of the main substrates. This is the main glycosphingolipid that's in myelin, very important. This is probably a side product that shouldn't be made, but it is. This is toxic. You kill the oligodendrocytes that make myelin in the central nervous system, Schwann cells that make myelin in the peripheral nervous system, and then you get myelin arrest, degeneration. You get a breakdown of some of the myelin that's already been made. You get a macrophage response. Well, where are the places that we can intervene to change this? Well, obviously, I think we need to supply Gelsey activity by some mechanism. We could think about substrate reduction therapy. It's been tried. It's not that good. We could decrease the immune response because we know there's an immune reaction in this disease. And if these myelin-forming cells are already dead, we may have to supply some through neural stem cells or some type of stem cells. So what are the major issues with the treatment? We have to know when does the damage begin. Now, in older patients, the older woman, I'm sure she doesn't have serious problems, but I don't know when it began. Now, how early do we have to treat? What's the best way to deliver Gelsey activity globally to all the cells? How important is it to treat the inflammatory component? Some of these we have answers. It's important. How much Gelsey is enough? We don't know that. We do know that there are people who have polymorphisms, have quite low activity, and have no disease. How do we deliver? Could we deliver too much enzyme as I showed you, it starts out as an 80 kilodalton creature, so it has to be cut. Well, if you made way too much, you may not be able to process it and add sugars and trim it back. These processing enzymes might be overwhelmed, and what could it do to other enzymes that have to be processed? How important is it to treat the CNS and the PNS? Very important, as we'll come to. What's the combination that's effective? And I always believe in safety. Now, this disease is interesting because although people make knockouts for other diseases, there are naturally occurring models. The twitcher mouse, there's a high incidence of Krabbe disease in Cairn and West Highland White Terriers and other species, and rhesus macaque monkeys. The monkeys have not been used a lot. They have one birth a year, and one in four, you have to only breed heterozygotes. So we've used the mouse as our main way to look at this. But the one thing to keep in mind, and it's sort of putting a damper maybe on my own research, is we can do quite well treating a mouse brain. With the 2,000-fold difference to the size of the human brain, you can see the challenge that we have to get global delivery to something this big from something that's working well in a mouse. We are treating the dogs and getting some very good response. I don't have time to talk about it. Now, what's been tried for treating this disease? Bone marrow transplantation has been done, and I'll show you the paper, 1984. That's what, 26 years ago, there were 36 years ago. They were already doing bone marrow transplantation in twitcher mice. Substrate reduction therapy, enzyme, all of these things have been tried, not all of them with great success. We'll talk about our work with an AAV vector. There's been the use of non-steroidal anti-inflammatories, antioxidants, IGF-1, chemical chaperones, combined therapy. So many things have been tried. I think we'll come to what we think is working right now. This paper by Andy Yeager, back in 1984, again, we're talking about 32 years ago, he had a paper that said he was just going to do hematopoietic stem cell transplantation of twitcher mouse. He got an extension of life. These mice live about 40 days. If untreated, they live to be, on average, 60, 80 days. A couple live to 100 days. He got some activity in the peripheral nervous system. He said repair of demyelination in the PNS, but he thought that there was not much correction of the central nervous system. And he suggests here maybe we have to disturb the blood-brain barrier to get more cells into the brain. Now I've had my own ups and downs with viral vectors in terms of whether I'm upbeat or downbeat. But there are ways that we should think about, and I think now I'm more upbeat about the use of viral vectors. You have to be able to make a highly concentrated stock. You have to be able to get convenience and reproducibility of production. The reason why I say that is if we end up going into a human trial and you need to make batches and batches of virus, they have to be consistently the same. If you end up getting different titers, different purities, and you get different results, you can see that you're going to have a problem. They have to transduce the cells of interest. We would like them to be the Schwann cells and the oligodendrocytes. We would like long-term expression and no immune response. This is the vector we use. I'm not going to go over anything. It's a AAVRH10. M stands for murine or mouse, gal-C, cDNA, and it's got promoters, et cetera, like that. We make it, or we have it made at the University of Pennsylvania vector farm. So we did some initial. What I'm going to show you is how we've evolved to try to get longer life, more safety, and more effectiveness. And initial studies that we did using AAVRH10, we did some with 5 and 2, but I won't go into that. We injected intracerebral ventriculi and in the cerebellum at 2 days of age. Well, the mice start to have symptoms about day 20, and we always hear earlier is better. It's the premise of newborn screening, it's the premise of many things. Earlier is better. So we were doing them at day 2. We did some intravenous only at 2 days, and some we did a combination of into the brain, into the cerebellum, and intravenous all at day 2. We published that. So what happened to the mice? Well, here's the longevity, and you're going to see these for a few other treatments. Just look, here's the untreated. The average age of death is 50% of the mice are dead by day 40. IV alone, you've extended the life out another 15, 20 days. Once you start injecting into the brain, you get an extension of life. When you do all three methods, the blue, you get some mice live 150 days, with the average being around 100. And in some, we gave a second IV injection. And although some of them died young, a couple lived quite old. Well, we were quite happy about this. We thought we could do better, and maybe I have a personal bias against injecting into the brain and what it entails for human patients. So this gives you weight, and weight is always a good measure, because if mice maintain their weight, it means they're eating and they're drinking. So you can see these mice hold up their weight, and then near the end of their life, whether it's ICV, ICIV, here's just untreated, they lose weight very, they go up to 10, they go right down. This is a normal wild type. So we felt pretty good, but we thought we could do better. Now, this is where we get to be fun. Here. So these are 130-day-old male and a female mice that have received the three treatments, intracerebral, particularly IV, intracerebellary, and IV. So they should be dead at 40 days. So we're starting to see where they're, the first thing that usually goes in the mice is hind leg weakness. You'll see this mouse who can pretty much climb up and out. So there's a great improvement in their, I would say, their quality of life, and in their weight is maintained. They can go up the side of the tube and of the barrier. So then I came up with the idea that maybe we should not inject IV, but wait till day 10. Well, why wait till day 10? Well, we can inject more because the mouse is bigger. This is the age when myelin begins in mice. Now, we know that humans myelinate before birth. Mice start around day 10. But anyway, I thought that maybe giving a lot of this the vector and a lot of enzyme before the axons are fully laid out, maybe that was not good. So we waited until day 10. And this would maybe correspond more to a human, where we have to have some time between diagnosis and starting any treatment. So these are 2-day-old. These are 45-day-old. Now, they're not much older than an untreated mouse. These were litter mates. So you can see an untreated mouse here, that's laying here or something. These have been treated with one intravenous injection at day 10. They lived about 90 to 100 days. But absolutely normal. They explore, they eat, they drink, they climb around. There's absolutely nothing wrong. They just didn't live a real long time. Now, I always show this picture of this mouse because I loved her. She was 80 days. She had 6 litters of pups. So this does not, the Twitcher mice are only 40 days when they die, so they never breed. She had a beautiful coat. She had 6 litters. That's almost as much as any mice will have. She lived to be 1 year, almost on her birthday, she died. But I just like this because she was such a good mother. She got pregnant as soon as she had one litter. She was at it again, and whatever. What we're interested in, of course, not only are we interested in long life and weight and everything, we're interested in the myelination. So here, this blue area is good. This is a Luxolfast blue PAS. This is an untreated 45-day-old. You can see it's full of, these are globoid cells, the red cells. This is in the spinal cord, and this is in the sciatic nerve, which, as I say, is untreated. At least in our case, it's really the bone marrow, untreated is very bad to see this. Okay, I'll show you more when we do it. But here's normal sciatic nerve. Here's 50% IV treated. So we knew we were getting activity. You're seeing much more myelination into the cerebrum and the spinal cord. Not as many of these red macrophages. How about electron micrographs? Again, this is what a 40-day-old, when they're near the end of death, they have edema, they have macrophages, they have globoid cells, they just look terrible. This is one 63-day-old that just got one IV injection of vector. Oops, sorry. Now, what are we doing now? And this is an evolving our studies keep evolving, trying to get closer and closer to a human trial. So now, what if we combined a bone marrow transplant with at around day 10 with AAV only? But why combine these two? Well, HSCT, or hematopoietic stem cell transplantation, is a standard of care in patients who have Krabbe disease and who are diagnosed young. So we're starting with a known procedure that extends life with some problems, but does extend life. Bone marrow alone increases the lifespan of Twitcher mice. We know that. Andy Yeager showed it 32 years ago. And we felt that the blood stem cells will help with the inflammatory component, where the AAV will supply a quick dose of enzyme. And we published this last year. Now, a lot of this is based on studies from Dr. Escalar, who's here, in 2005, that published a paper showing transplantation of umbilical cord stem cells into pre-symptomatic and compared it to symptomatic, but the symptomatic patients extended their life. There were problems, we didn't feel that they were completely corrected, but this set the tone for the standard of care right now. It's almost why there's newborn screening, is that there is a treatment. While it's not optimum, it does extend life and provide some correction. Now, this is rather colorful, but I don't want you to worry about everything here. This is just enzyme values, GALC, the enzyme missing in Krabbe disease in a wild type. So you see values 1, something like that. This is an affected, some are 0 or very, very low. This is a bone marrow only. And this vector, this AAV, RH10, vectors have tropism. They have an affinity for certain tissues. And what you can see is, look at the heart, let's say. If here's normal, it's between 0.4 and 2, and affecteds are very low, the activity that you get in the heart, very high activity. But this is what we're interested in, the sciatic nerve. The sciatic nerve is what is untreated in human patients that get umbilical cord blood transplants only. And we're getting supranormal activity in the sciatic nerve. Let's look at the extension of life. Now here you can see untreated, again about 40 days for the untreated. Here you can see AAV only. So it extends life another 20 days, with the one exception, there's always an outlier, isn't there, that instead of dying somewhere in this range, she, with all the pups, lived to be 1 year. This is bone marrow only. Again, it extended life to about 80 days, what Andy Yeager saw 32 years ago. When we combine these two methodologies, this is the lifespan that we see. So we're seeing now, in fact, this mouse here is 680 days. We hope in a month and a half or so, it'll be 2 years old, which is almost the lifespan of a mouse. They should be dead at 40 days, so keep that in mind. You can be impressed by this, but remember, an untreated Twitcher mouse, average death is 40 days. Weight. Again, the weight is important. It shows they're eating, and it shows they're drinking. I don't have them all the way out because I didn't make a new slide, but it continues. The weight of that 600-plus-day-old mouse is at 19, 20 grams, the same as what it was back here. This shows 275-day-old Twitcher mouse that was treated with combined BMT and IV, AVRH10, and we gave a wild type, just a normal mouse, a bone marrow. They get busulfan as a myeloablative technique before the bone marrow, and then we did that. They would, because they're a little bit smaller. I'm sorry. What did I do? So anyway, we gave the wild type mouse a bone marrow transplant, this to keep them the sizes approximately the same. And I always forget which one is which, but it doesn't matter. They can move around, they explore, they're curative. I think the one that's 275 then is, I think it's 560 days now. Now, this is the one that counts. Thank you. track of these mice is to look at the just foot patterns. If you just put the front paws in red ink and the rear paws in blue, you can just get an idea of how well they walk. A normal mouse just puts one almost on top of the other. This was 150, this was 300. And we have more of those, but I mean, they're fun to look at. They just tell you that they're not dragging their butt all over town. And so we can use a stain called X-Gal, which picks up Gal C activity. If you use special conditions, you can see blue staining cells in the cortex, the cerebellum, the lumbar spinal cord, the sciatic nerve has a lot of activity, which is, goes along with what we measure by our test. Again, this is Luxol fast blue staining. Again, just keep your eye on a wild type, a lot of blue staining in the brain, and some of the cerebellum spinal cord. This is an untreated, you see a lot of globoid cells, storin cells, not very much myelination. And these are different ages, 98, oh, this is bone marrow only, I'm sorry. You didn't get much correction if you look in the spinal cord of a bone marrow only, but when you do combine bone marrow with AAV, you can see almost normal myelination by this method. This again, we're interested in the sciatic nerve. We want to correct the sciatic nerve, we think it's undertreated. And I think this is a dramatic slide where you see wild type, this is Luxol fast blue staining sciatic nerve, and untreated, bone marrow only, and different ages of bone marrow plus AAV. So you can see the wrapping around the myelin is pretty normal. This again is colluding blue. I think this slide is actually very good where you can see wild type, all this edema, stored cells, not much. You can still see some myelinated cells here that are wrapped. But when you get with the treatment with bone marrow and AAV, you can see that it almost looks like normal. So in summary, I have a few more slides after that, but basically we found that a single dose of this vector puts normal activity in the CNS and the PN. Just that. Doesn't prolong life more than 20 days, but it's telling us that this vector can get activity into the CNS and the PNS. These mice have no tremor, which the twitchers do. They're fertile. They live an average 34 longer than untreated, and one female that lived 1 year. And combining them results in a dramatic synergistic effect with much longer life than either one alone. And there's clear evidence from remyelination. I don't know whether it's remyelination or just normal myelination in the peripheral and central, less gliosis, less edema, less inflammation. We've done dogs. We worked with the people at the University of Pennsylvania. We've done three. We had done some earlier with injections into the brain. We've changed over to this method with bone marrow plus AAV, and we had one die recently at 60 weeks, I guess, and the myelination in the central and the peripheral nervous system was completely normal. So we're working up to a bigger animal. There's always a question of numbers. We cannot get the numbers. Let alone forget the monkey. But even in dogs, they're not big litters. 1 in 4 are affected, et cetera, et cetera. We're just not getting a huge number. So we're going to have to stick with what we have in the mouse. Additional, we're working now on dosing, and timing is what we're doing now to see if we have a window of opportunity for treating. And where do we go from here? Well, this is where I hope we're going to go from here. We're planning, we hope, you're going to get a diagnosed individual. You're going to have low Gal C activity, obviously, as the enzyme defect. We're going to look for mutations, make sure that they fit with the clinical phenotype, and we're going to get neurodiagnostic confirmation. There'll be a 10 to 20 days when you'll get HLA typing, donor selection, reduced intensity chemotherapy, and the child will get an infusion of hematopoietic stem cells. This is what we're working on. Can we wait a week? Can we wait 2 weeks to give the AAV injection? Only IV, nothing in the brain, nothing in the spinal cord. You will then give AAV, and this is what we are hoping for, an improved lifespan, quality of life. After the treatment with the vector, there'll be lots of neurodiagnostic studies, nerve conduction, looking for immune reaction, vector distribution, Gal C distribution, and organ function. It's going to be very important that we do this right, and that we have the data that says this is a safe and effective way to go. Now, there are some concerns with the treatment of Krabbe and other lysosomal diseases, and we all know that from that you have a diagnostic lab here, and I do. Some patients are severely affected when diagnosed, and maybe they would only get supportive care. Some are so mild that maybe we should not do a life-threatening or dangerous or very expensive procedure. It's very difficult to predict the clinical course, especially in late-onset patients. As soon as you go into, whether it's Gaucher disease or Niemann-Pick or Krabbe, as soon as you go into later-onset form, the variability, even patients of the same genotype, even siblings, it's very hard to predict what the clinical course would have been with or without the treatment. And then which treatment to use. I'm right now thinking that a hematopoietic stem cell transplantation coupled with gene therapy is going to be the way to go. And when to start is going to be the big question. So what other factors do we have to consider when thinking of Krabbe disease? Well, one is the infantile patients have a very rapid course. There's no doubt when they're picked up by newborn screening, when they're picked up because of a previous sibling, that we've got to move fast to get that patient into some type of therapy. But in the later onset patients, the ones that have a later onset, diagnose them at a significant 6 months, a year, 2 years, you've got a window. You don't have to rush. You can finish your clinical studies and then you plan when to start therapy. And again, this idea of real late onset patients is difficult to present the clinical course. So we have a few more obstacles to overcome. One is the need for early diagnosis before neurologic symptoms are significant. So there's the role for newborn screening. And I can tell you, as a person who has my ups and downs with newborn screening, if the therapy is good, I'll be the biggest drummer that this is the way to go. And I think we have to do better for this disease than we have right now. So we need to prevent the earliest pathological changes. We need to supply galactic activity to lysosomes and the myelinating cells and the PNS and the CNS. We need safe and effective vectors that will work in all of these tissues. We need more studies on dosing and timing of gene therapy in the mice and the dogs. And then we have to do some additional studies, maybe related to toxicology, to confirm that an IV injection of this is safe. Now I'm finished, because I always have to finish up with some words from the wise, people that are wiser than me, and Bertrand Russell is certainly one of those. And this was a cartoon from the New Yorker where, if you can't read, a scientist extended the life of a fruit fly. This nurse is telling this elderly gentleman. And so maybe you could say the scientists have extended the life of the twitcher mouse. But again, we wanted to get it into human patients to have it do some good. And these are the people. Muhammad Rafi has been with me since 1988, Paolo Luzzi since the early 90s. Han Zero is the widow of Chen, the one who helped me purify it. She took him back to China in 93 where he died. She came back the next year at my tech, and she's been with me ever since. She's amazing. If you want someone to inject the tail vein of a two-day-old mouse, she can do it. She's phenomenal. Helps in the diagnostic lab. And Charles V. and Allison Bradbury worked with the dog model. And I couldn't have done it without the support of the Legacy of Angels. Most of them are missense, but there's 150 of them. My problem with that is the general global delivery of this. You can transduce cells, but how do you get that into a global situation to a living child? You need to get into that brain. And the peripheral nervous system. I thought maybe you were going to say, with some of them having missense mutations, aren't you excited about pharmacological chaperone therapy, where you could, if it goes to the brain and the CNS, whether that could alter and create 3, 4, 5% of normal, which may change the clinical course from an early onset to a later, or provide an ancillary treatment. I'm more thinking that that people send me things all the time to try, and there are a couple that work. They work for very specific mutations only. So.
You say that it were successful in screening FGF1 and 2 for peripheral enzyme replacement therapy, that it caused up the blood-brain barrier, we're able to talk about that now. Would that be a reasonable treatment for Krabbe?
Well, we're back. I have a slide which I didn't show, which is why I'm not enthused by enzyme replacement therapy. The data so far has been horrible. It has absolutely no evidence that it works. The idea of making a lot of this, the reason why it took me 25 years to purify the damn thing was not because we were that stupid. It's because it's so small amount of it, you need very little. And also because it's so hydrophobic. It'd rather stick to glass, it'd rather stick to anything than be easy to solubilize. So now the idea of making a lot of this, it is a little bit daunting to me. But whether you can get it across the blood-brain barrier through manipulation is possible. The idea of doing it every 1 or 2 weeks, like you have to do for MPS1, which does a better job on the liver and the lungs and other things, it is easier for me to envision. But so far, the papers that I've seen, and I was on one of them, I was underwhelmed by the paper that I was on. It was not encouraging to me that this was the way to go. But I tend to think if you can have these vectors, we know that one of the mice that died of 606 days, the normal is expressing beautiful Gal-C activity in all the tissues. We're doing copy numbers now to see whether the heart and the liver and places that have, like sciatic nerve, that have higher activity than brain, do they have more, did the vector go there better? So that's what we're doing right now. But it looks like for the life anyway of the mice and the dogs, there's continued expression with no evidence of an immune response. I'm more concerned about an immune response when we get into other enzyme replacement.
Okay, thank you.
Very well.
A world-class leader in the area of birth defects, but importantly, is the editor of MMWR, which has a very high impact factor. And I want to also comment about Dame Laney, who will follow her, who is a genetic counselor from LSD Clinic, so I can introduce you together. First, Sonia.
So it's my honor today to have a chance again to talk about Paul. And to get some inspiration this year, I looked back at Paul's website, and I talked about his website before. I love this website. If you haven't looked at it, this is the website address, www.rememberpaulfernhoff.com. When I first looked at it at CDC the other day, it gave me one of those warnings that you can't. So don't try to look at it at CDC, because somehow it's blocked at CDC. So look it on your own time, on your own time. It must have been a lot of people looking at the website. So, but it was wonderful again to read the many tributes and funny stories and to hear about the innumerable ways that Paul had made a difference in people's lives. So I decided this year to use those words to make a word cloud. So. Little did I know, I went to the internet, I'd seen these word clouds, and so I looked on the internet, and little did I know, there's a free word cloud generator. Who knew that such a thing existed? And try explaining that to your grandmother, or if you're my age, to your mother. The program counts all the words in a document and then displays them in a cloud, with words used more often displayed more prominently or bigger. I inserted the text from the website into the program, and like magic, a word cloud appeared. So I'm going to show you the word cloud. This is the Paul Fernhoff word cloud. So I just want to point out a few things in this, because I like this word cloud, my first word cloud. So, I think it really represents many of the facets of Paul's life. First of all, his work. You can see both Emory and CDC are listed. Emory a little bigger than CDC, appropriately so. And also genetic, medical, health, testing, doctor, colleagues, but I think most importantly to Paul, the kids, their parents, and their families. Second, I think you can see some of the words that represent the man that Paul was. Mensch, I like that word. Ethical, sharing, passion, love, special, kind, and caring. But I thought most importantly, I really like the way that this turned out, that it came up as Paul as a husband and dad in the word cloud, as in his life, his family plays a central role. You see really family right in the middle. So I hope that you agree that this word cloud represents Paul and his life nicely. So I read a quote just this last week. They say you die twice, one time when you stop breathing and a second time when somebody says your name for the last time. And based on Paul's website, based on his word cloud, the fact that we continue to have this meeting every year, and the difference he made in so many people's lives, Paul's going to be around for a very long time. Thank you.
That's great, Sonia. I love this word cloud, and I thought when you said the idea, it was just brilliant, absolutely brilliant. I am here to give you the update on how we've been preventing the second death. Okay, so this is our update. I always want to remind you the different ways that we are trying very hard to get Paul's name out there and remember what an amazing person he was. And one way is all of you here today and being able to get really world-class speakers to talk about topics that were near and dear to Paul's heart and have continued on with him, with his legacy. And look at these amazing people. And look how nicely they sort into red and black. the Paul M. Fernhoff Excellence in Teaching Award has been given out 3 times now. And I am very excited to announce that Kate was first, Cecilia was next, and I actually got it last year. This is something that's voted in by the students themselves. And we don't get to, you know, nominate ourselves or anything. It's really something where they pick from their professors every year. So I was shocked and crying and amazed. But once they said that yarn chromosomes were involved, I was like, oh. We also have, we are now in our 5th year of the Paul M. Fernhoff Fellow. And you can see we're doing really well. We have now, for the first time, one of our fellows has left Emory, which was shocking to me. And it means I can't get a picture of everybody together, but I'm going to start doing headshots. We also have the Paul M. Fernhoff Merit Scholarship for a genetic counselor student. This is a partial scholarship that's given based on merit, and it's a really exciting way for us to get the best and the brightest to our genetic counseling graduate program. Last night, this is like a real-time update, Wei Zhao was our first honoree of the Paul M. Fernhoff Memorial Lecture Series Award for Outstanding Contributors to the Newborn Screening and Infant Health. I think some of the CDC made that title. We also have something that I really find amazing, which is education on the high school level, because Paul was always about teaching. In fact, the point where Angela, at the point, was our clinic nurse, would like yank him away from the learners so he would go see patients. And this is a fine example of his dedication to teaching. This is the Fernhoff Program in Ethics and STEM at the Atlanta Jewish Academy. And I believe they're in their third year. So pretty exciting, moving right along with everything else. One of the things that Paul was very interested in doing was always educating patients across the board. And one of the things we've done with the extreme help of the Legacies of Angels Foundation is came to the website called Think Genetic. And it's really a way when people are googling in the middle of the night after they just learned about a diagnosis or a possible diagnosis or are just tired of trying to go from doctor to doctor, for them to get a little bit of information and then next steps. Where do we go from here? Where do I go to get taken care of this? How do I get tested for this? Just really basic things that they get in front of people they need to be in front of. So it's up and going. It's amazing to me, but you can go check it out. The duck race is Saturday. The ducks are like getting ready. We've got the cupcakes sitting around outside my office so you can get prepared for this great event. And the duck race is extra special to me because the last time I saw Paul was he doing this at the duck race. This is our first annual duck race, and Paul died on Sunday after service, or well, Monday morning, but you know, I saw him on Saturday. So I thought it was a fitting memorial. And all of those genetic counseling students who are up for possible scholarships, right? They're there and they're helping. So, plus which my children who get drafted into whatever I'm doing. And this is just what it looks like. It's chaos, there's ducks. The water guns are used to spur along those ducks to get the fastest ones there, and people win fabulous prizes, of course. It all goes to the Paul Endowment Fund. The race is Saturday, and it's over on Emory Claremont campus. If you guys wanna come visit, that's great. And if you wanna adopt a duck, feel free to see me. I've got the forms here with me, or you can do it online. So I thought that I'd end before we go get our very tasty wine as provided and mixed by the Evanosky Foundation. You can talk to the vintner, he's gonna be out there with you. I want to give us all a challenge. So one of the things that I do when I'm advertising the duck race is I put information on the duck race and the family fun day that goes with it on mama listservs in the area, on the CDC parent listserv, which is an amazing resource. We just found all about Down syndrome soccer yesterday. And I put it out on my neighborhood listserv. And I would invite you to think about what kind of comments might happen if you got your information put on a listserv. Would somebody be excited about it? Would somebody who knew nothing about the person posting it comment on it? And I think that Paul's one of those folks that when I posted something on a random listserv, I got more comments than you would ever imagine. People who said, this man changed my life. Hey, I didn't know you knew that guy. I know that guy. You know, it was dark days and he really helped me. And I think that the way that he did that was through compassion for families. And I would challenge each of us to do something really compassionate for somebody over this week in memory of Paul. And you get bonus points if it's somebody you're really not happy with. And I think that this is the kind of quote that we want about us, living or dead. This is from someone in my neighborhood who I didn't realize knew Paul. She said, I love that man. He saw us for P and G, those are for two different sons who are about 4 years apart, and he was so kind and amazing to us. I can tell you that he saw one of those women lying there in a bed with a baby who's already passed away. So for someone to say that 5 years later is pretty amazing. So I challenge us to dig deep for our compassion, go have some wine, and do my Paul Fernhoff challenge. So, thank you.
Invite everyone to attend the reception outside after this and mingle and chat along. And I've also just been told, Bob just told me hot off the press, that next year Maria Escalar will deliver the lecture. So get all ready for Maria's wisdom. So thank you very much, and we'll see you outside.